Hi, this is Michael DeArruda, priest in the Anglican Union for the Propagation of the Gospel, and it's my delight to be with you here today on this Easter 2024. This is my 71st. After all these years, isn't resurrection sort of old hat? Well, if by old hat we mean it's the same refrain every year, Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. Yep, I guess you could say the same thing one more time. But this year, I've seen something new. I've got an impression that I'd like to share with you if you care to listen in. Isn't Easter really an ancient Germanic spring ritual that got Christianized? I've heard that so many times over the years, but just dismissed it as a cheap shot designed to embarrass believers, as if our faith is some kind of warmed-up leftover, not the real thing. But what if that's true? So rather than sweep what could possibly be an inconvenient truth under the rug, I decided to take a little bit deeper look. Well, it turns out that there's only one original source that asserts this claim, and it comes from one of the most beloved saints of the church, the Venerable Saint Bede. He lived in Northumbria, England, 700 years after Jesus. His ecclesiastical history of the English people is considered the most important original source on Anglo-Saxon history and the development of Celtic Christianity. Imagine a history book that starts with the Roman invasion of England in the year 55 and spans forward 600 years, ending with a detailed account of how the date of Easter was finally set for the Church of England. Perhaps you didn't know that in those days, three different dates were observed, which you can imagine caused quite a stir among believers. In fact, in one instance, while the queen was celebrating one day, the king was celebrating another day. In the year 660, the famous Synod of Whitby supposedly settled the matter, but that's a story for another day. The point is that in his account of what happened at Whitby, Bede says that Easter was originally the feast of a pagan goddess, which was later Christianized. Now, even though there is no other source for this claim, Bede was such a rigorous historian on most matters that the idea of Easter being a Christian takeover of a pagan practice persists to this very day. So is there anywhere else we can go to find out whether Bede was correct? The Oxford English Dictionary, the most revered source on the origin and meaning of words among English-speaking people. The OED is the undisputed authority on the derivation and use of words in the English language, and according to it, the word Easter goes much further back than its northern European and especially Germanic use. Easter comes from the word meaning east, and was specifically used to speak of the rising of the sun at the vernal equinox. What is that? That's the exact moment when in the natural world, light begins to overtake darkness. When is that? When the sun is exactly above the equator, making day and night of equal length. This is the moment in late March, where we are now, when the darkness of night begins to be overtaken by the lengthening days of light. When Germanic people received the gospel, the word they had long used to speak about the rising of the sun, when darkness began to dissipate after the long cold nights of the northern hemisphere's winter, naturally became associated with the rising of the Son of God from the darkness of death. So consequently, Easter was no longer simply a word to describe the dramatic, observable change in the physical world. For believers in Northern Europe, Easter became the name of the most profound spiritual significance, describing the most important transformation of all, the resurrection of Jesus of Nazareth from death to everlasting life. All people who have received and accepted this mind-boggling, world-changing news, not simply as a statement of fact, dusted off and trotted out of the closet each year, but rather embraced as the pivot upon which all life and all reality rests, we hold fast the promise that because he lives, we shall live also. From the moment of his resurrection onward, everything is being reconstituted so that life and not death is the center of our existence. The Apostle Paul explained this to the early church in Rome. If we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. In other words, the Son of God's rising is the precursor to our rising. Easter is synonymous with resurrection, specifically the resurrection of Jesus from utter annihilation to glorious life. We're not talking about resuscitation, like children playing a game of back to life, Jesus being physically dead in one moment but suddenly restored to the life he died to in the next. No, not simply re-entering the physical state he left when he breathed his last on the cross. No, the resurrection of Jesus was to life with a capital L, and even that, of course, does not begin to explain it all. Life which is even more abundant, more than any kind of life any other human being has ever lived, a life completely free from evil, sin, and death, life on a scale, life of a magnitude unequaled in human experience, life that God created us to have, to know, to experience, and to be caught up into with him for all eternity. Feels very far off and removed from our day-to-day experience. Now someday perhaps we'll know whether good old Saint Bede was right about a pagan ritual being co-opted by the church. But I don't think that really matters in the end. Why? Because regardless of what practices, symbols, or seasons are used to represent the life-altering event of resurrection, they all pale in comparison with resurrection itself. This Sunday, believers throughout the world are hearing the gospel declaration of the angel telling Mary at the tomb, "He is not here, but has been raised as he said he would." Believers who, like me, have seen a lot of Easters come and go, many of us with more miles and scars than when we began, and some who, because of the particular ravages of our lives, we feel very far from the promising light of this season. A few days ago, the phone rang. "Mike," the caller said, "I need you to tell me how big a sin what I'm about to commit is." Knowing my dear friend as I do, I expected him to chuckle at the end of that sentence, but he wasn't laughing. He was dead serious. "Okay, tell me." "I just can't go to church this Sunday. There's going to be a lot of joy and celebrating. I can't do it. So how big a sin is it that I won't be in church on Easter?" I took a breath. "Peter, you're off the hook. There's no gradient here. In fact, there's no sin." I knew why he couldn't go. A week ago, he sat in the front pew, sobbing, in the memorial service conducted for his wife. Even though he drank the message of life after death like a thirsty dog, his whole being is exhausted, melted by this loss. We talked a bit more. "Pete, your grief is precisely what this feast is all about. He doesn't expect you to gin up anything that you're going through. Friends, you and I have had ample reason to be where Pete is. Maybe you're there right now. The fact that we are being carried through the valley of the shadow of death by the very one who overcame death, is our lifeline between the nights of darkness we have now and the days of never-ending light Christ is leading us to. And that's reason for celebration, even if it's through tears. Let's pray. Lord God, we don't know how to begin to fathom how wonderful, how profound your resurrection is. But we have tastes of it. We have glimmers of it. Still, Lord, the challenges, the chances and changes of this life constantly call the hope and promise of life beyond death into question. So we ask that you strengthen us this day and for all the days that you give us, that as long as we draw breath, we may yet be drawn closer to you, that at the last, believing in you, we may be eternally caught up into the resurrected life of light with you and the Father and the Holy Spirit. Amen. A blessed Easter to you all.